So last week we started a series called Contending for Rest. How many of you remember? We started by defining or trying to understand what the Bible, specifically in Hebrews chapter 4, says about rest. So I'm going to recap it quickly and then we'll get into the series. We discovered that rest is not only resting from our works, but we find rest, as clearly implied in Hebrews chapter 4, when we gather with His church, His congregation, His assembly, away from the world, like right now, in His presence, to do three things. Number one, to celebrate. Number two, to celebrate and to feast. So, you know, when we're doing praise and worship, or when we have feasts, you know, downstairs sometimes, we're talking about food now, hallelujah. In the presence of God is actually rest. And number two is to serve one another. When you serve one another, you will find rest. And number three is to bring sacrifices unto the Lord. Sacrifices of praise, sacrifices of worship, and sacrifices of the labor of your work. That will be the offerings and the tithes before the Lord. You see, those three things I talk about, celebrating and feasting, serving and bringing sacrifices, are all activities of what? Of praise unto our God. Psalms 22 verse 3 tells us that He inhabits the praises of His people. And so when you praise Him, the presence of God would come down. And Exodus 33 verse 14, God said to Moses, "My presence will go with you." Why? Because My presence will give you rest. So the presence of God is what brings rest. It's not really the activities. It's actually the presence of God. And that's why Jesus is inviting His people. You are His people. So especially those who are weary and heavy laden or burdened, to come to Him, to His presence. And oftentimes it's very difficult during the week. And so we have an opportunity once or twice a week. We enter into the presence of God. Why? Because in His presence, that's when you have a break. That's when you can rest. That's when you can get recharged, refueled, and refilled with His goodness, with His strength, with His Holy Spirit, with His glory. I remember how many of you were around or alive, because I think it's quite a few years ago, when the airport church was having a renewal. Remember that? How many of you were here? Wow. Okay, let me tell you my experience. So the renewal was happening in the airport. At the height of it, there were a lot of people going there every single day. Now, Toronto Star did a research on it, and they did a publication on it. And so they interview a fellow who would be there every single day from Monday to Sunday, with the exception of Saturday. I think Saturday was when they took a break. But Monday to Sunday, every single day, he would be in the house of the Lord. So he would go to work 6 o'clock in the morning, and so he'll work, and then after that, he will rush straight to church. And so they will have this thing going on. You see, he had to go there early because you had to line up in those days. I remember when it first got started, they were still meeting in that small little industrial area. Me and my wife also were lining up, you know, just waiting to get in. Wow, that was so exciting, you know. And so we finally got in. And so, you know, so you had to line up. So if you want to be sitting in the front row, you have to go like 2 hours before the door opened. Oh, I pray for that day. You know, you had to wait for 2 hours to just get into the service so that you can have a front row seat. And so he would rush to church, and he would start lining up around 5 o'clock. That was initially, but later on he said he was involved, so he didn't have to rush anymore. He just, you know, go straight in and serve and whatever. So he'll go there every day, and then, you know, some of the people were there. Do you remember that the service would go on and on and on and on? After that, they would pray, and then after praying, you know, people soaking and praying in the Spirit, and then the thing wouldn't finish until 1 o'clock in the morning. And then off he went back to work. I mean, went back to sleep. Had about 3-4 hours of sleep, and off he go again. And he was doing it constantly. So the reporter asked him, "Aren't you tired? How long can you keep this going?" He said, I don't know how long I'm going to do this, but I am not tired at all because I'm supercharged. I'm more hopeful. I have more strength. I am more encouraged. I have some energy in me that I don't know where it comes from, but I just love doing it. I can't wait to get back to church, and I'm not tired at all. You know, on Friday, we had a little bit of that taste of that. I was leading worship for 2 hours. My hands were so tired. And so, you know, can you imagine playing piano for 2 hours? That's a lot. And so, and then after 2 hours, you know, I said, okay, good night, everybody. I stepped down, and people didn't want to leave. There was such a rich presence of God here. It was amazing. You know, when you're in the presence of God, there's so much strength. There's so much joy, and there's so much hope. You see, when you go to sleep at night, what it does is that it doesn't rest your mind. If you are a psychologist or you study the brain a little bit, your brain is going full throttle while you're sleeping. Did you know that? The only thing that is actually rested is your four limbs, if they're rested at all. Some of you just move around a lot. And so that doesn't really give you a lot of rest. And it's rest nonetheless, you know. And so, or sometimes you sit down just to relax, just to rest. Those are good rest for your body. But when you come to the presence of God, this is what He promises to do, is that He'll give you rest. Not only your physical being, you will feel like you are recharged, you will be recharged, but you feel like your mind is more alert now. You feel like now you are more hopeful, you are more strengthened, you have more courage, you have more joy. Those are the strength that you can't find by just lying down horizontal. Because if you're depressed and you don't have Jesus, when you wake up, you're still depressed. When you're discouraged and you have no Jesus, when you wake up, you will still be discouraged. And so, but when you come to the presence of God, when you come and worship Him and you bid His call, as He did to the people of Israel, come and worship Him, you find that in His presence, there's fullness of joy. In His presence, there's strength. In His presence, there's hope. In His presence, that's courage. Now, the enemy of our soul, Satan, who is also in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, says, is the God of this world. He will throw everything at those who are to make the decision to answer the call of God, to go to the desert place, to be separated from the world, to be in rest. That's why rest, or to enter into God's rest, must be contended. There are two places I remember where God had told us to contend for something or fight for something. Number one is Hebrews chapter 4, verse 11. It says, let us therefore strive, or contend, or labor to enter into that rest, so that no one may fall by the same sort of disobedience. And another one is Paul says, fight a good fight of faith. And what is that? What is fighting a good fight of faith? I would submit to you this morning is to fight to the place of rest, because faith must be in existence if you need to rest. You can't rest with no faith. You cannot rest with no faith. I tell you, a lot of people have no faith in the grace of God or the bigness of the grace of God, though. So they keep on striving and striving and striving for God's approval. And they keep on feeling guilty and condemned all the time. I tell you, if you are fully convinced that God had forgiven all your sin, and that your standing is never changed in His presence, never changes in His presence, and that if you come to Him, He is faithful and just, He will forgive your sin and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. If you believe that, you can actually rest, because His grace is so big, it will cover everything that you have done and everything that you are going to do. So you are going to have to contend for rest. Contending for faith. Actually, Hebrews is actually a book of faith, right? It talks about rest. In order for you and I to get into that place of rest, you need to have faith. So there is a contention there. There is a fight there. So today, I want to show you what happened to the people of Israel. They heard the good news first, and then they believed. And they thought rest will be handed to them on a silver platter, and they have to do nothing for it. Turn with me to Exodus chapter 4, verse 29. Then Moses and Aaron went and gathered together all the elders of the people of Israel. Aaron spoke all the words that the Lord had spoken to Moses. And not only they spoke, they did signs in the sight of the people. I'm going to talk about that signs and wonders later, because that's very important. And the people believed. And when they heard that the Lord had visited the people of Israel, that they had, and he had seen their affliction, they bowed their heads and worshiped, because good news have come. Afterwards, Moses and Aaron went and said to Pharaoh, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, let my people go, that they may hold a feast to me in the wilderness." Go to verse 4. But the king of Egypt said to them, "Moses and Aaron, why do you take the people away from their work? Get back to your burdens." And Pharaoh said, "Behold, the people of the land are now many, and you make them rest from their burdens." The same day, Pharaoh commanded the taskmasters of the people and of their foremen, "You shall no longer give the people straw to make bricks, as in the past. Let them go and gather straw for themselves. But the number of bricks that they made in the past, you shall impose on them, and you shall by no means reduce it, for they are idle." Therefore they cried, "Let us go and offer sacrifice to our God. Let heavier," everybody say heavier, "heavier work be laid on the man, that they may labor at it and pay no regard to the lying words." So in other words, what the devil is attempting to do is to make you not believe there is a place of rest. Go to verse 19. The foreman of the people of Israel saw that they were in trouble when they said, "You shall by no means reduce your number of bricks, your daily task each day." So they came to Moses and Aaron, who were waiting for them as they came out from Pharaoh, and they said to them, "The Lord look on you and judge, because you have made a stink in the sight of Pharaoh and his servants, and have put a sword in their hand to kill us, because we believed you. We believe what you say. And now look at us." Chapter 6, verse 9. This is the important part. Moses spoke thus to the people of Israel, but they didn't listen to him anymore. Because of their broken spirit and harsh slavery. I got a few points to make here. The first is the promises of God to us will always be resisted by the enemy of our souls. It ain't going to be easy, including the promise of rest. The promises of God that he had given you, every single one of you, if you had paid attention in the spirit, he had spoken promises to you, and you know it's from God. A dream that you know that he'd given you. But you know what? Those will never come easy. Anything and everything that God wants to grant to you will meet with incredible resistance. Actually, let me rephrase that. Will meet with fierce resistance from hell. In fact, the devil himself will rev up the heat to intimidate us so that he could break our hope and break our spirits. Go back to 6:9 again. They did not listen to Moses. They no longer, in other words, believe what Moses and Aaron had to say about the rest, about God is setting them free from the yoke of slavery. because your broken spirit and heart slavery. If you have made a decision last week when we preach, and you say to yourself before the Lord, Father, I am going to pursue rest. I am going to pursue that rested lifestyle. I'm going to have a rested life. I'm going to find myself in the presence of God, receiving His rest week after week, day after day. I'm going to make a determination that I'm going to make myself available, clear my schedule, change my work priorities, change my work arrangement so that I can come into His presence and rest in His presence. There is a likelihood that you were intimidated by the devil this week. Instead of getting rested, things may have gotten harder to cause fear in you. Instead of getting rested, things are getting restless. The pain you were asking the Lord for, you say, God, I want to have that rest from my pain of my sickness. And that pain this week had become more pronounced. Sickness that you're believing to get rest from. God, I want to rest from this sickness, this illness, this cancer, this stomach problem, this joint problem, this bone problems. This week, the devil reminded you more. He will probably make you feel sicker. And your finances, oh, you heard about the Sabbath of finances. You brought your sacrifice to the Lord. You started to tithe. You started to sacrifice unto the Lord. And guess what? You get laid off. You got into an accident. You got into some kind of oops and surprises. And you said to yourself, God, I thought you were going to give me rest. You have more pressure now. Every time when we decide to challenge our status quo of being in slavery, the devil will put up resistance to resist you all the way. He's not just going to go, oh, please don't. He's going to go, no, you cannot. And how dare you challenge me? I'm going to make you sicker. I'm going to make your finances more broke. I'm going to cause you to tremble. I'm going to cause you to get pain, and I'm going to resist you. And I'm going to remind you that you shouldn't believe what that preacher say because he's a liar. When we decide to challenge and resist failures, sickness, hardship, and everything that will steal our rest, we can pretty much guarantee a blowback from the devil. You can take that to the bank. Some of you say, I don't want blowback, I'm afraid. That's why we sing the song, we're no longer slave to fear. I preached it so that we can all get prepared. There'll come a time that the devil is going to put up huge resistance towards your rest. He'll say, no, you're not resting. We're going to enslave you to the day you have your last breath. You know what the Word of God says? Resist the devil if he resists you and he'll flee from you. But the Word of God also says that when Jesus himself had found himself in the darkest moment of his life, he came to rescue us. He came to deliver us. He came to cause us to be free. Of course, he faced the most incredible resistance. He was whipped. He was tortured. He was put on a cross, and the Father turned his face away from him. And the Bible in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 says, looking to Jesus, the founder and preferer of our perfecter of our faith, who for the joy, everybody say joy. Joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus, how he overcame resistance, because resistance is going to come, is he keeps looking at the joy that is ahead of us, so that he could despise the pain and the resistance that is right now. If you are sick, if you are struggling in finances, whatever that you're struggling, the point is to keep looking at the promises of God. Keep believing in the promises of God. That will give you joy. That will give you hope. And when you keep looking at that, you will find that the resistance is not as bad. Come on. The joy of the Lord will fill your heart as you look to the promises of God. So don't look at, he wants you to look at the immediate. So the Jews, they basically saw all the problems they was contending with, and it got bigger. They got bigger. And it will keep getting bigger before they finally get to get set free. But I will assure you this. I will assure you this. God is going to walk with you. I'm going to show you how he's going to do that. So Jesus looking at the promises. So I want you to do that right now. The promises of rest. Rest from your sickness. I need you to close your eyes and imagine this. He says that God, Jesus imagined and he saw us, which was his joy. The salvation that would be rendered to us, that was his joy. The soul that he would bring to the Father, that was his joy. For the joy that set before him, he, despising the shame, endured the cross. Despising the shame, endured the pain. Just imagine the promises. The promises that you are no longer lonely anymore. The promises that you won't be lonely. The promises that you won't be rejected. The promises that you won't be in lack. The promises that you won't be in pain. Just imagine how painful you are. Just imagine. What would you do without those knee pains? What would you do without those headaches? Just imagine. Just look at yourself. By faith, see yourself healed. By faith, see yourself being relieved from pain, relieved from rejection, relieved from suffering of all sorts. Oh, for the joy that is set before you, promised by the Father, you will be able to endure whatever the devil is going to put up in front of you. It's the same thing as, you know, I always use me as an example because I don't want to use other people, then they get offended and leave the church. You know, when I was in university, if you've been here for a while, you know, all of you know I hate school. School and me, we weren't friends, and I don't think we'll ever be friends. And it was hard. It was hard sitting in Robarts Library. You know, some of you went to U of T, you know where that is. Sit there. Those chairs, man, they don't have cushions, man. They got cloth on it. You know, it's like thousands of people sitting on those same chairs. All the cushions, it's gone. You know, it's just cloth. You sit there and try to study. And I have an attention, I don't know, problem. So I'll read for 20 minutes. I need to take a break, walk around, and come back. So it would take people like 2 hours to study. It would take me 2 days just to finish the same thing. Oh, I didn't like school. So many a times I want to give up school. Oh, for the joy of getting graduated from university. The joy of having a great job. A joy that I will have money to buy a car for myself. A joy that I'll have money to buy a house for myself, to get myself a girl, and eventually a wife and children. Oh, that joy, I saw it. It was beautiful. And for the joy that was before me, I endured school. Come on, young people. Are you here this morning? Some of you are giving up too soon. Stay the course, man. Now, let's go to Exodus chapter 6. Oh, by the way, there was a sister. I don't know if she's here this morning, but I'm going to use her name. I won't use her name. So on Friday night, you know, after the praise and worship, you know, we're having chit-chat, and it was so fun. I just enjoy so much, you know. So I saw her, she was saying, oh, it was so hard to come. I wanted to come to church. And she said, you know, but our bus just had to make a big detour because there's some accidents and it was snowing and all kinds of stuff. But she made a determination. Everybody say determination. To be in the house of God on Friday. And the devil, man, threw everything in his trick books and nothing worked. She was here. And I asked her, was it worth it? She said it was worth it. Oh, it's worth it. Every single time. Some of you overcame snow. I'm sure it crossed your mind. Oh, my, look at it snowing. I guess it's safer for me to stay home, not to have to drive. I never get that because people are taking a bus to church even in the snowstorm, you know. And some people who are coming with the bus, you know, there's something in your mind saying, oh, just take it easy. Just stay home today, okay? Look at the snow. Oh, my, look at the snow. It's coming down. Throw in the log of wood and just go relax, have a hot chocolate. Come on, you know what I mean? Every single time you've decided, I want to be in the house of the Lord because you want to go and rest. You want to find the presence of God and you want to rest. And you remember it was great, it was restful, and God restore you all the time. He'll renew you. He'll give you joy. He'll give you more hope. And He'll give you more courage. And His word just shower you and encourage you and give you more faith. And so you want to go, and the devil is throwing everything possible. Your boss calls you, you got to work today. You know, speaking of work, if your boss knows that you're committed to your faith though, not laziness, if your boss knows that you're committed to your faith, they won't touch you. I'll tell you this, if you are a Muslim or a Jew, they wouldn't call you to work on Friday or Saturday. But Christians, they call us to work on Sunday. Why? Because they know we are not as committed. Ouch. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. If I offended you, please forgive me. So but it's true. If you said, I tell you, there are some people, there were a couple of Mennonites, they had a testimony in Waterloo. And this brothers and sisters, they were Mennonites, so they had to go to church on Sunday. And so they were working part-time job in the summer picking strawberries. And so, and then they went to their boss and said, listen, we can't do Sunday. We won't be coming on Sunday. We're gonna go to church. And the boss said, what? What do you mean? So the boss fired him. And guess what? They took that strawberry, whatever, manufacturer or processing company to court. And they won $70,000. So now there is a precedent. So go ahead. Sue them. They took them to Human Rights Commission. And Human Rights Commission awarded them $70,000 for this brother and sister. Because the boss tried to prevent them from going to the house of God. We're living in a great country. A lot of us Christians complain, oh, you know, all those other religions, you know, they seem to be like having all the breaks and we got nothing. The reason we get nothing is because we don't say nothing. The reason they got nothing is because we don't even lift our finger. The reason we got nothing is because we just, okay, you can beat me up. Whoa, turn it on our cheek for sure. But I tell you, you're a Canadian citizen. You have all the rights that everybody has. You need to start standing up for your rights or that rights will be taken away from you. That's not part of the preaching. It's just a bonus. Come on. If your boss say you got to work on Sunday, you say, I'm going to church. That alone itself guarantee employment for the rest of your life if you wish to. Because if they touch you, there is a cause for you to go to court. Make sure you document everything. I always counsel people, you know, you want to succeed in corporate life, documentation is king. Document, document, document. You can never over-document. Anyways, let's go back to preaching. Okay, verse 6, chapter 6, verse 10 to 11. So the Lord said to Moses, go in and tell Pharaoh, king of Egypt, let the people of Israel go out of this land. Chapter 7, verse 8. Then the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, when Pharaoh says to you, prove yourselves by working a miracle. Then you shall say to Aaron, take your staff and cast it down before Pharaoh, and that it may become a serpent. So Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh, did as the Lord commanded. Aaron cast down his staff before the Pharaoh and his serpent, and it became a serpent. Now, the interesting part is the next line. Then Pharaoh summoned the wise men and the sorcerer, the magicians of Egypt. Also, they did the same thing by the secret arts. For each man cast down his staff, and he became serpents. But Aaron's staff swallowed up their staffs. In fact, the magicians were able, if you continue on, were able to duplicate another two massive miracles that Moses did. Number one is to change the river, the water in the river of Nile to blood. So the sorcerer could do that. They could turn water into blood. And then later on, the frogs, call out the frogs. The sorcerer did the same thing. They call out the frogs out of thin air. This is my point. A few ones. If you are contending for what God had promised you, on your way there, you need miracles. God will always prove to you the promises He had for you, including rest, with miracles. We're talking about work. You'll be surprised how your boss will give you such great favor. This is called miracles. The boss that may even hate your guts, all of a sudden that you say, okay, go ahead on Sunday. That's miraculous favor. Or that God will get you an even better job. But on your way, in your contention of your faith to receive the promise of God, in your healing, rest from sickness, rest from finances, rest from all sorts, God is going to give you some surprises along the way called miracles. Miracles are very important. Let me say this, miracles for this house, in fact, for any house that supposedly preached the Word of God, is an essential element, is a must. It's not a nice to have. I'll tell you why. Because they're not for show. Our faith, Paul says, cannot rest on just words alone. Your faith and my faith cannot rest only on what man say. Miracles are there to confirm His Word being preached. We believe in miracles in this house. It's not so that I can do a show for you. I believe in miracles in this house. We pray for miracles. We see miracles. We celebrate miracles because it tells us that God is in our midst and what we say is true and what He's saying is from heaven. You know, in Mark chapter 16, verse 20, the Bible says, after they received the commission from Jesus to preach the gospel to all nations, the Word of God says that they went out and preached everywhere, and the Lord worked with them. And what? Confirmed the message. Everybody say, confirm the message. By accompanied signs. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 3 to 4 tells us, salvation was first announced by Jesus our Lord, was confirmed to us, those who heard Him, and was affirmed by what? Signs, wonders, various miracles, and gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to His will. In other words, can I boldly say that? If you disagree with me, we can still be brothers and sisters, okay? If there is no miracle take place in places where people are supposedly preaching the gospel, you and I have reason to question if what they say are truly of God. People think, oh, modern days, you don't need miracles anymore. Do you know it's harder to convince people these days about the gospel than ever before? In the old days, at least they still believe in some kind of God. These days, they don't believe in nothing. Of course you need miracles. Of course you need signs and wonders. That's what confirms what we say is true. Let me tell you something else. Those who do not follow Jesus, who do not follow the God we serve, are also operating in signs and wonders. You know, our church, some of you heard this before, used to meet in an industrial park. I'm almost done. We used to meet in an industrial park, and we rented like 3 units or 4 units, I can't remember, 4 or 5, whatever, and we converted it into a church. So it's really comfortable. Actually, I would stay there forever if I could, you know. It got a nice chair, very cozy. I got my little office and got a children's area. It was really nice. I you know, we built the stage, and I do a lot of things around it, and it was like I'm my baby. I really enjoyed it. Could sit only 80 people, though. Just not too many people able to squeeze in there. We had an event one time that about 200 people showed up. So we have to line up all the chairs outside. Some of you were there. Remember Sadhu Sundar Salvaraj, his name? He came, you know, he's like this weird-looking prophet. He's an amazing preacher. He has a big follower in North America, but he's a charismatic preacher. And he only wear orange toga, which is kind of weird. And he had long hair. So I remember the Full Gospel Businessman people came to me first time and showed me the picture. Said, we'd like to ask if you want to sponsor this guy. I said, what is this? You know, is he even a Christian? What are you guys thinking? So they said, no, he believed he's a sadhu so that he could reach his people, because his people only believe or listen to sadhu. So he thought, okay, if I have this outfit, then I'll identify myself with them, and so they can actually listen to what I have to say. But the guy was, you know, full of miracles, and he prophesied over his church. It was pretty amazing. But, you know, we got people like visiting from Montreal, New York, whatever, came out of the woodwork, and we thought, wow, we didn't know this guy has so many followers. So we have so many people, it's just like we have to line people out outside that auditorium and put them outside in the hall, put a speaker out there and open the window so they can see inside. Oh, it's amazing. I was thinking to myself, hey, man, if we could do this every Sunday, it would be awesome. But anyways, one can always wish, right? But anyways, so we were in that location, and after about 3 or 4 years, moved in this Hindu temple right across our church. And then, of course, the brothel, you know. And this Hindu temple, you know, one day I thought to myself, I want to be a good neighbor, right? I walk over across, and I shook hands with the priest. He took me into the temple. And I feel like, ugh, inside. But I say, oh, God, praise the Lord, greater is he that's in me. Hallelujah. So I walk in. You know, they have all these images and whatever, right? And so those images are there to instill fear because they look very fearsome. Some of you from that background, you understand what I'm talking about. It's like, right? So that people can be fear. So that's what religion. Religion always want to instill fear, right? Including Christian religion, you know, Catholic and all that. Always trying to use fear. Fear is not of God, man. Come on, just we no longer fear. We're not slave to fear in Jesus, and we're free of fear. Well, anyways, I was invited, and I was, you know, sitting, and it was so nice. He gave me a cup of tea. You know, I pray over the tea, hallelujah, and drink the tea. Thank you, Jesus. And so we were talking, and I noticed on the wall, there are all the crutches. I said to him, what are these for? Is this some kind of decoration? Ignorant. He said, no. These are the people that came in crippled and left whole. You know, Pastor Cho Yong-gi had a really amazing story before his church exploded in Korea. That was in the 60s and 70s. He started his church, you know, after the Korean War. And so he said in one of the services, I was there, and he said, you know, I came to the Lord one day because my people, all those dear saints of God, they come to my church in the morning, and in the afternoon they'll go to Buddhist temple. So he was really puzzled. He asked them, why are you guys going to the Buddhist temple? You're supposed to be Christians. But they say, Pastor, the miracle's there. Those monks can pray for sickness and they get healed. And so, he came to the Lord. He said, God, I am serving a big God. I'm not serving a God full of words. In fact, if you ever go to Pastor Cho's service, he preached a very simple message, no big revelation, and he has a million church members. And he'll tell you, you come to my church, you're not going to get big revelation. I always tell people how God loves them, he wants to bless them, he wants to heal them, boom, a million people show up. So he came to the Lord. He said, God, if we're going to do something, you got to give us miracle. And they prayed and prayed, and miracle came. And that's when this church started to explode. These days, we have rejected miracles because it's too hard to believe. Because every time we believe for something, there is a contention. There is a resistance. So we stop. The Bible says hope deferred makes the heart sick. So we feel sick because our prayer is not being answered. So we stop. But ladies and gentlemen, do you realize that every promises of God, every miracles, every signs and wonders requires that you understand that you will face resistance. You will face fearful resistance. When Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego resisting the Pharaoh, do not want to worship the idols, the Pharaoh revved up the heat. Was it seven times? And threw them into the fire. And it is in that fire, in the midst of fire, they saw a miracle. Ladies and gentlemen, that's what God has intended, is that when you're in the midst of your biggest storm, you will see lights come through. You will see His miracle come through. You will see His healing come through. When all hope is gone and you are hanging on to Jesus, you say, I'm going to continue to believe. Ladies and gentlemen, that's when you see miracles. Most Christians these days is that they believe in something. They hear a preacher like me preach a good preacher. They get all motivated and nothing happened. Next day, they get disappointed. So they start complaining. Now, God is a God of grace. He loves you. Even if you complain, He still loves you. He understands. But may I encourage you, when you choose to walk in miracles, when you choose to walk in faith, when you choose rest, when the whole world is in chaos, but you're pursuing that rest that is illogical, that is inexplainable, you choose to pursue it. Ladies and gentlemen, may I assure you that there will be resistance from the enemy of your soul, but keep fighting the good fight of faith. Paul says, I press towards the mark. He had to press it. He had to keep pressing it because there's resistance. You can do it. You are able to do it because for the joy that is before you, keep doing it, keep going, keep pushing, keep having victory. You may fall from time to time, but get yourself back up and keep going in Jesus' name. I know you will see your victory. I know you will find your rest in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Miracles is your portion. Miracle is my portion. The magician, the sorceress, the other forces of darkness, forces of fear, if they're able to do miracles, surely we are supposed to be serving the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the biggest of them all. Hallelujah. Surely the God we serve, the God we rely on, will let us see the miracles and the promises that He had made. He is not a dead God. You know, do you realize that in the world we live in today, many people already tap into the spiritual world, have access to the spiritual world. Because there's something bigger than us live around us. Scientists may say, it's stupid, blah, blah, blah. But yet, with all the advancement of science, with all the advancements of scientific research, people are still looking for the supernatural. They may not come to church because many of our churches have rejected supernatural. We only go with, you know, argument, debates, and good orientation or good word. But we've rejected miracles, so they don't come to church anymore. But they still know human. Distinct in our instinct, no, there is something bigger out there. And so we go pursue it. I always say that the biggest spiritual expo in this city is the Holistic Expo that takes place every year. They have between 70,000 and 80,000 people attending the expo. People go there to look for truth. And you know, I know some friends that have a booth there. They'll show me the people that visited those places. They're Christians, Pentecostal, no less, some of them, looking for power because they know something is bigger out there. So why would us then, who had been afforded the greatest power. How do I know that? Because the Bible says, greater is he that is in us than the God of this world that we just read about. So why would we not pursue that? Why would we not want to see that? Oh my goodness. There's so much spiritual blessings God had afforded to this church. And we decided, because of the sake of decorum, for the sake of order, for the sake of truth looking nice, for the sake of not offending people, we've abandoned the power of God. Paul said, I did not come to you in 2 Corinthians with eloquent words, but with demonstration of the Holy Spirit and power. This is what we're believing in God for. And specifically this morning is that it is going to only through miracles, signs and wonders, favor of God, that you come to that place of rest. For those of you who are sick, that place of rest will only come through the route of miracles. If the doctor can't tell you what's wrong with you, that means God is waiting to heal you. I don't know who I just spoke to this week. They say they have some stomach problem and they don't know, and the doctor have no idea what it is. You know, God bless our medical community, medical science community, the doctors, the nurses, some of you in that medical field, I'm sorry, but you know, you do your best, right? But your knowledge of the health of human body is still very limited. You can only cut so much away from a person's body. Are you here this morning? We need miracles. We need a move of God. The rest for your finances will also require miracles. That miracles that will give you supernatural wisdom to become overcomers of things. To see things that the masses will not see. Then you will be able to manage and thrive in your miracles. It is a good thing to rest in your finances. I tell you, it's sweet. How many of you know how sweet it is never have to worry about your mortgage? Just imagine this, okay? See, my wife and I, we don't have to imagine this because we experienced that miraculously quite a number of years ago. So we don't have to worry about mortgage. No debt. Oh, it's sweet, baby. That's rest, man. That's like, oh, this is so good. And it's your portion. It's your promises. I don't care if the houses in Toronto is $1 million. My goodness. But walk in his miracles. My wife and I, we walk in his miracles. We've been faithful in our giving, faithful in our tithing, faithful in all that God had called us in terms of finances. And it took a miracle. Actually, it took many, many, many miracles. It's yours. It's yours. You don't need to struggle. Now, you're going to start tithing, and the next day you get laid off. Like the Pharaoh. And all of a sudden you go, oh God, where are you? Where's your promise? I don't want to believe anymore. Boom, you stop. Don't stop. Keep on the fighting. I tell you, in this church, I know a number of people who are very faithful. I tell you, they're taken care of. They may not have a $500,000 job, but they're able to afford a home in the city and rest in their finances. Father, I thank you this morning that you have promised us rest. But I also thank you this morning that you have revealed the trickeries of the devil, the tricksters that is in his sleeve, how he would want to break our spirit, break our hope by resisting us, by putting more burden on us. But as we know, Lord, as the people of Israel, even though sometimes they struggle in disbelief, they complain, yes, they eventually was taken out of the hands of the Egyptian. They were able to go into the wilderness to worship you, to serve you, to love you, to enjoy freedom from the slave, the taskmaster of the Egyptian. And you have promised every single individual here a rested lifestyle, rested not only physically, rested financially, emotionally, spiritually, from sickness, from disease, from hardship, from broken hearts, from hurt of the past. The promise is that. So we want to live in that.